So the next session, I want to talk about applying what Lars just talked about. So we have this nice reference architecture, and in the end, it's all about can we actually use it? Because it's nice if we, you know, think about things in the corner of our office about how the world should look like, but applying it in real life is what we need to have. I will stick to a logical layer, so I will not go into physical implementation to show you. We have done that as well. So we can talk about that. But basically, in the group, we had this discussion ongoing. Well, what about when it's not a single sourcing environment? So it's not an IT organization that needs to automate itself. But what if, you know, it's using sourcing from a lot of different partners? So there was this work group started, which is basically going after multi-sourcing. And initially, we start to scope it very big, which meant we had endless discussions about what should be in. So we stopped that and said, let's focus on first incident management. There's two objectives which we want to achieve. And I'll talk about that. So the first objective was, can we actually apply the reference architecture to do to handle a business problem? A business problem of IT, of course. And in this case, we're going to look at multi-vendor incident management. And then the other part was, if we're doing that, can we actually identify if there are issues with the reference architecture itself, and can we improve that, and how do we use that going forward? And finally, if we have then at least done some work on it, what are the conclusions for multi-vendor incident management? I have to warn you, it's not going to be rocket science. We purposely took a very simple item as first, just to test out our own work. So, going back to Lars's introduction, he has shown this the structure of the reference material. And like Lars said, the core part is the function component, the lifecycle artifacts, and the service backbone artifact associated with that. However, for applying a reference architecture, that's not enough. And as Lars was indicating, we have scenarios and capability disciplines. So what we did is we started off with creating a scenario, in this case, multi-vendor incident management, and start to say, okay, if we want to do multi-vendor incident management, which capabilities do we want to use? So that's where capability disciplines comes in. So we took our own structure of what we said, this is what the reference architecture is all about, IT for IT reference architecture, and we applied it in the scenario. In our structure, Lars has talked about these levels, so I'm going to stick to level maximum level 3. I'm not going to go any further in my discussion. And this is a representation of the reference architecture. We're trying to, you know, bore you with this as much as possible so that it sticks. But basically, when I look at this as the core of a reference architecture with the function components as the blue boxes and the artifacts as the black dots, and the purple dots are the service model backbone. Come back to that later. And this is really what we bring to the table as saying, okay, so let's apply, if I do multi-vendor incident management, how does it work? We actually have to scope it down to a focus area. And like I said, we try to do it simple, something that everybody knows, but that's where really my focus is going to be today. So what happens around this in an environment where we do multi-vendor sourcing? Now, we've started on this journey basically right from the start, and we said we need to understand what is about sourcing, what is there. And we step back a little bit and first start to say, okay, so what are kind of guiding patterns that we can see? You know, when we talk to amongst ourselves in the group, we quickly notice that there are different ways of how organizations look at sourcing and how to incorporate sourcing in their line of thinking. They make choices that have impact on how you implement, finally, a solution. So we stepped back and said, can we define a common pattern which everybody uses, or do we need to, you know, understand there are multiple of them? And actually, we found out there are multiple of them. So let's first talk about what is multi-sourcing. So in our journey, we took the line of thinking as there is a line of business with customers. You know, they're servicing their customers with whatever they do. Selling oil, selling insurances, selling, I don't know what, nails, whatever. There is a central IT, which basically is responsible for the IT operations, having a CIO office, PMO, help desk, all kinds of activities happening there. And then there are kind of services that are consumed from external suppliers. And those are things like hosted services, the tower business with sourcing, HP does that as well, outsourcing is called a lot. You know, these are typical things. But you also have cloud services, which are much more agile, so that's also there. But anyway, the different ways of sourcing externally. And one thing that we did do is say, okay, a lot of companies, when they source, you know, you can actually look at a lot of internal departments as just another sourcing partner. Not external, but internal. So let's not differentiate between internal sourcing and external sourcing. Let's standardize that. It's basically sourcing. And it can be internal or external. Makes life much more easy. So that's one thing that we did. But that when you look at it from a distance, then suddenly you say, okay, so if I have all these elements coming in, and I at the bottom of the picture, and I need to support something centrally towards my customers, my internal business units, the consumers of my IT services, there needs to be something in the middle that combines it. It can be very simple, just a brokering function, which basically takes services and wraps only an SLA around it and provides it to the consumers. But it can also be as complex as I take different types of services, combining it into one, and provide it to my partners, to my consumers. So the concept of service integrator is a second element that we brought into when we talked about multi-sourcing. There needs to be something that is responsible for the integration in an IT organization. And again, that can be sourced as well. It doesn't necessarily have to be something done internally only. So just the information flow, basically what happens is information comes from consumers. They ask what they put in the demand, which goes to the service integrator, service providers provide the information back, and so on. So this is a very simple information flow that we took a look at. So with these concepts in the back of our mind, we started to see, okay, so if we have all these different implementations of how sourcing is done, can we find standard patterns? So the first one is, and we recognized and we started to name them. And this is just to frame them for the rest of the discussion. The first one was central setup, basically meaning there are situations where the organization that says we want to do the sourcing, they decide we implement something in a tool and we manage the data in one place. And all of our vendors, all of our partners have to log into that same instance, that same tooling, and work on that same artifact. There's no way all the way around it. So this basically means everybody logs, works in the same tool and interacts in the same way. It's not a very common pattern, but it is certainly something that we see as a potential. Now, when you want to define, when you want to use the reference architecture in this picture, it basically means that you have one functional component, and in our example, we have the incident management function component, with one artifact. And for the completeness of the picture, I added here the CMDB function component with the CI, the actual service CI combined with it, to show that it's in the end not a standalone tool. There are relationships with it. It becomes more important for the other patterns. But basically, it's one function component, one artifact. That's the important part of it. And if they are owned by the service provider or by the service integrator, not really much of a difference. It's one instance, that's what you work in. But it has implications on how you organize yourselves and how you work with your partners, of course. The second pattern that we identified, we named replicated. So basically, it works a little bit differently. The capabilities that you want are still the same, incident management as a capability you want. But in this case, you don't have one functional component, you have two functional components. One is by the sourcing organization, and the other one is by the supplying organization. And both have, you know, an implementation of themselves. Can be the same tool, can be a different tool, but they have their own implementation. And they also have their own artifact there. And suddenly there's a whole difference in what needs to be done. And we'll go into details on that. But this, of course, looks very different than the previous pattern. And the third pattern that we recognized is one we called referenced. And this is why I had the event, an extra, artifact, an extra function component added to the picture, is because sometimes you see the situation where the connections are across organizations. So for example, we have somebody sourcing, cloud environments, and we want to set up not an incident management process in that organization. We just want to understand when something goes wrong on the cloud environment, again, an event coming in, creating an incident in our own environment. So instead of really, forcing everybody to work in the same tool or copying the data over, we have a difference in you handle events and you connect with my incident management system in my environment, as an example. So this is what we call reference. These are the two patterns, and we can debate about variants of this, but these are the ones that we noticed. For the rest of the presentation, I'm going to keep the reference out because it adds more to the confusion if we keep on doing the same thing over and over again. So with these patterns, with this guiding, and we've described all of this in a guiding document. We promised we do guiding documents. One of those is available, which is about the multi-sourcing and what the impact of that is in the reference architecture in general. We then said, okay, now let's apply this and let's stick with incident management here. So, first of all, in order for me to really talk about it, I had to step back and understand, so what are we talking about? What is the concept? It's nice that we have this function component and artifact level ID, but we need to have something that I can talk to with my business. I mean, they're not talking about functional components to me. They're talking about, I want you to be able to manage IT. And as an IT management capability, you need to be able to handle incidents. So as one of the core elements in the reference architecture, we added capabilities. Not to prescribe capabilities in any way, shape, or form, but we took market standards like the ITIL and COBIT and you name it, and we harvested those capabilities into the model to use. We actually have a repository which stores those capabilities with descriptions on it, which are linked to function components. So if you want to build an IT capability model with that, you can start doing that. So here you see the representation in ArchiMate notation. So we actually want to show that we also use other standards in the open group. ArchiMate notation of a capability, in this case, incident management. And for those who actually can read it, I would applaud you because it's too small. Within it, a process step. Now, a process. Now, again, we don't want to prescribe process because that's something that is for other standards already there. We don't want to reinvent the wheel. We actually say we harvest them, just like the capabilities you harvest process. So in this case, incident management is pretty straightforward incident management process, which is all fine. Anybody who has done anything in IT before could have drawn that picture. It's not very complicated. So the other ones are actually also not complicated. What I did is with the central setup, we suddenly have this, boxes of organization around it. And the way we describe it here is when you look at the incident management process with a central setup, your supplying organization suddenly, focuses on the same process internally. And your sourcing organization is actually the owner of the whole capability, including the triggers going in and out of that particular capability. So this is how we describe this, the central setup. And then on the other side, we have the replicated version. And I'll do it on the screen, otherwise you won't see it on the other end. So basically what we said, in this case, we suddenly have two organizations which have their own setup of a tool, which basically means they also have their own setup of the process. But from a capability perspective, it's still one capability. The whole is the capability that we're after, incident management. So we said there is a kind of a synchronization happening in this particular template. So we have incident management process on the sourcing and an incident management process on the supplying part. That's all fine. And then the triggers in and out are basically handled on the sourcing organization as a responsibility. So if we look at this, this is fine. So it tells us we need to set up two processes, basically. But that doesn't help me much yet with understanding how to actually implement a reference architecture and make it real. So in order for me to understand this, I went into, okay, I want to have a version of a process like you see here with all the boxes you see with the arrows pointing to the right. Those are steps in an incident management process. And you can look up any process. I don't really want to prescribe anything here, but this is a incident management process. But what's more important, that from a logical view, from a perspective of logically how things are done, I don't have a duplication of the whole process. I only have a have a set of steps that are suddenly handled outside my own organization in the replicated setup. So basically, I need to understand where I'm going to hand over, where I'm going to say, this is now somebody else's responsibility. And that's where the process helped me at least think about it. So I have arrows going across organizational boundaries. And it helps me already a lot. The other part is that I have this data object, the business data object, which is basically telling me there is an incident object. But if I look at it, there's a version of it on the other side with my supplying partner as well. So I have suddenly the need to also synchronize data between two organizations. So by just applying the process, the standard that you adhere to, and putting it into this perspective using the patterns and using the reference architecture, I understand I have a data synchronization and I have a interaction needed at business level between two organizations. But it goes further because the reference architecture helps me to understand there's other information that needs to be available. So it's not only about the incident suddenly that is there. If I do incident management, I need to be able to connect to configuration management. I need to be able to connect to problem management. I need to be able to connect to maybe change, maybe defect. There's all kinds of interactions. Event might be there. So these are all necessary to understand how does this work. Do we copy the data or do we have one and suddenly have a referential set pattern for that relationship, or do we really copy? So these are suddenly discussion points that you can bring to the table and having everybody understand what do we need to set up. And as I show here, we basically have configuration management, change management, and problem management duplicated. So that has an impact on it. That's a choice that has been described here. And you can make different choices, but okay. It's still a reference architecture. So then we have an understanding what we wanted to do. There's the next layer is that, okay, how do we actually how do we go to the physical layer? How do we go to the application layer? And for that, we use the term what we call essential services and functional components. Essential services are services that are provided by the functional component to support a capability. And in this case, it's an incident management process, so you have an essential service which manages an incident provided by an incident functional component. Again, architecture notation, argument notation here. And the central one, we've discussed that before, the setup with the organizational setup and the hierarchy of that, but basically it's one function component. But when we look at the replicated pattern, which is much more interesting in our case, we suddenly have this situation where I don't have one process, I have two. Although they interact with each other and logically it's one process, I suddenly have this need to have multiple functional components, which means that I need to provide services that in exchange this trigger, because I have this process trigger and I have this data exchange. So that's why we have suddenly this extra box here in the middle, which is called case exchange. And again, you might not be able to read it, but case exchange is basically the term that we used here. So from a reference perspective, a reference architecture, that's not in the reference architecture. In our reference architecture, we don't find it. But in the guiding documentation, it is clearly explained that in order for us to handle this type of information, it's there. And it's part of the, and therefore it's part of the non-normative part of the reference architecture. If I look at the more detailed version, and it becoming much more squinting eyes, and Lars optimistically said, we can put it on one A4 and can talk about it. Well, as a hardcore architect, I'm more than happy to create these type of diagrams just to make it more complex. But the bottom line is that I want to have an overview of what is connected to what for me to be able to understand this. So in here, we have the same process, in this case, with the separation between the two organizations. And suddenly, I see the duplication of essential services exploding. I have, on two sides, a lot of essential services. Now, this also means that I can go to my partner, if I'm sourcing, and say, look, this is our setup, this is our process, this is our way we work centrally, in our own organization. We do set up case exchange, and these are the services that I expect you to provide. And as a partner that provides services to a sourcing organization, I can say, if you standardize on something like IT for IT, I know which extensive services you want to have for me to work with you. And that makes the my life much more easy in that discussion with my sourcing partners or with my partners. So just to show a picture or more detail on the case exchange itself, the box here is the case exchange in the middle. It's not only like we saw on the process level, it's not only the individual object or the individual capability that needs to interact. If you really want to do this correctly, if you're expecting CIs and changes and problems being connected to it as well, you now have the need, the requirement to actually expand the discussion with your partner to say, we expect you to handle problems. And because we expect you to handle problems, we expect that you expose a sensor service to the case exchange so that we can talk about that problem process across the line. We expect that you create CIs on your behalf. For us to we need to have then a sensor service that provides that CI to us, that information, so that we can put it in our process into the CI process. And this helps us to table the discussion what we need to do. And all of this was done using the reference architecture with the interactions between them. Now, I'm sure that a lot of you have implemented case exchange already in your organizations, so I'm not hoping that I'm not completely telling anything completely new, but the bottom line is, using the reference architecture, I was able to identify what needs to go over the line. So the next layer is the data layer. And this one was a little bit more interesting for me because this pointed out something in the reference architecture where I really found something, well, I need to discuss that with my peers in the board. So bear with me a little bit. But what is interesting here is that, on the top is the incident artifact that's being a business object that needs to be connected. And the business object, from a capability perspective, basically works together with a whole lot of other business objects. This is, defined from what IT needs to provide and how to service that. And on the other side, in the supplying organization, I also have a set of business objects that are connected to it. So when I start mapping that to artifacts, which are in the reference architecture, I can then find out in the reference architecture, there are connections between them, yes or no. I can see if the incident process, incident artifact, is actually connected to all of the business objects that I have. And what you can see here, that some of them do not have a direct connection with the incident business object. So the association that I use on the business layer, I can then map into the actual implementation layer and say, sorry, the application layer, and say, do I have that information connected in the right way? And do I know if all these objects can be used? Now, if there's no direct line in the reference architecture, it doesn't mean that it doesn't work. But what it means is that for, in this case, for example, let's take one, which is the knowledge article, is not directly linked to the incident. It goes via, in this case, the problem. So basically what it means that if you want to find a knowledge article related to to something that happened, you need to create that problem first. Is that the way you want to work? Yes or no? It's a reference architecture. You can define that, change that. The other part is, in the end, there is a connection to all the cardinality in the artifacts. So you do have the possibility to create at least the insight of what happens and what information needs to be connected. The other part which I found interesting is that there is this need to create this connection with defect. And a defect is something, certainly in the agile world, if something happens in operations, you create an incident. And sometimes the incident needs to be handled as a something you want to change. You create a defect for the R2D failure stream, basically. That means that I expect that I can create that connection. Now, when I look at the reference architecture, I notice that, so there's a weak link between incident and defect, but when I look at that from an artifact level perspective, there's no connection there. So basically it means, do we miss something in the reference architecture, or do we need to explain it in a better way of how to handle that information? So that's why this is what we do in these workshops, in this work group, that talk about a certain scenario. Okay, so finally, we need to get to a level where we can talk about the information actually exchanged. And in the structure that Lars introduced, we do have these artifacts. We're not going to go around and define artifacts for all attributes. There's attributes there. And we're not going to go and create attributes just for the fun of it. Actually, there are a lot of standards or at least open source type of work, bodies of work that we can harvest, that we can point to, that we can say, actually, if you really want to understand how attributes on artifact level looks like, that's one example. Incident has a lot of documentation around it, so I'm not going to pretend that this is suddenly coming up from where we are. But what we do have is we need to have at least these references to other objects in there so that I can create this cardinality between artifacts. So if I want to implement a solution that does incident management, I need to be able to connect to problems, to changes, and so on. I need to understand, do I create a connection on the incident side or on the change side, and where do we point back and forward, and how do we do that? So that's here for the actual implementation. So in the end, with this whole exercise that we did in the work group, we basically had a couple of conclusions. So in a central setup, no case exchange, data sync is not needed. The supplier becomes a resolution group. There's much more detail in the actual work group documentation. It goes too far to really go into detail here. But a supplier is just a resolution group. Measurement of performance needs to have something additional in your incident management system. Otherwise, you cannot measure the process of incident management across your suppliers. And measurement of service performance also needs something in the central system. With the replication, it becomes much more interesting. We do identify the need for case exchange. We need to have that triggering across organization. We need to have that exchange of information across organization. We also identify that as soon as you have that, suddenly your measurement on performance of your suppliers can be focused on that case exchange, because that's the actual handover point that you have. So measuring their performance can be much more focused on that. And finally, the SLAs, if you go to your consumer, still need to have something centrally. So with that, I'm at the end of my part of the presentation. I was told to have 50 minutes of questions, which is exactly what we have. So I'm open for questions or any input at this moment.
Okay, Case. Thank you very much indeed. Okay. My apologies for mixing the times up. I'm growing into the stereotypical role of professor and becoming more absent-minded as I age. We have a few minutes between now and coffee for questions for Case, and I think
For Lars.
Beg pardon?
Or for Lars. Yeah, from the previous session, because it was quite short.
Or towards Lars and Charlie, who are still in the room, I think.
Okay.
So Steve has a microphone.
There's a question.
Or you can shout from the corner.
Hi, could you just elaborate where or how far you are with the definition of the taxonomy within the various different use cases that you went through?
Okay, for this one specifically,
I was particularly interested in incident management, problem management. So the incident management, the problem management, you mentioned in the picture you show.
Yeah.
How far are you with the definition of the taxonomy?
Okay. So we have, of course, the function component, the artifact defined, and the taxonomy of those are defined. We have the relationship between the artifacts defined, actually much wider than the ones I showed here, of course. That's the reference architecture last show. We have set up all the capabilities that are necessary for an IT organization to have, based on standard that we harvested, so it's open for discussion if that's enough or too much or whatever, but we have that also. We describe those capabilities. We have mappings of function components and artifacts to capabilities, so which capabilities are basically responsible for managing those artifacts or being supported by that function component. We have done it for all. It's not all in the repository yet. We have two value streams already in the repository, two more to go. And then we have, for this scenario, we actually have much more detailed out on how the connections are, where we actually started to use essential services in a more detailed way. So initially we map an individual function component with one essential services providing support to a capability in or high level ones. In a scenario like incident management and multi-vendor incident management, we actually went down and started to individually have the essential services defined and described on these are the ones that we actually need. For the incident, we also have then the attributes associated with the artifact level, and we have the mapping of the artifact to the business objects, like I showed. So which artifacts are basically representation of a business object that you need to have in your application. So that's there. And next to the multi-vendor incident management process, we have started on service level management. It's work in progress. We started on Agile or DevOps or whatever we want to call it. It's wider. Agile. That's the work group is Agile, but it, you know. So that's work in progress. And help me out.
So
it's the core that we have, but then.
So Agile, just going back to the, or putting into the taxonomy of the reference architect, has been focused on requirements and defects, as well as portfolio backlog items. So all the concepts that you typically see as artifacts in the SAFe framework, for instance, and trying to map out the core attributes that needs to be there. Now, it is early work, as you said. It's not like you're coming with a complete standard where please sign and start using it. So that's why we're soliciting more people to come in and add to it. But it's also, on the other hand, it is so that we have examples of how to do it and we've seen that it works, right?
So apart from the work on paper, like you saw here, we actually have also implementations of actual tooling connecting and working according to this reference architecture as well, so that we can show it can be implemented and can get to work in that way. So that's also something, but it's not taxonomy anymore, but that's also available.
That has been very important for us to not just say that we can make the paperwork in terms of we can describe a scenario and see that it, with these attributes it all works. We want to make sure that we have real customers or IT organization, I speak as a vendor, but IT organizations that are actually implementing something like that.
Okay.